press the bell icon on the YouTube app and never miss another update.
In the last class we discussed about the catalyst and types of catalysis, promoters and that adsorption theory and all. And very important the characteristics of catalyst, that is selectivity and activity, as well as the shape selective catalysis, right? Let us move on to the last concept of this catalysis, that is about the enzymes. What is that? Enzymes. So you are familiar with this term also. So this enzymes, so they are nothing but the biocatalyst. What are enzymes? Enzymes are the biocatalyst, right, which increases or which alters the rate of what? Biochemical reactions. Okay, so what are these biochemical reactions? The reactions which are taking place inside the living organisms, right? You know about your digestive processes, like conversion of sugar starch to maltose, conversion of maltose to glucose, or the function of the salivary amylase which is present in the salivary juice, right? That is, the salivary amylase is nothing but an enzyme. So they are nothing but the biocatalysts. That's why they increase or decrease the rate of biochemical reactions. That's why I'm specifying that enzymes are biocatalysts. Actually, these enzymes are nothing but the proteins, right? Enzymes are proteins. You know this line. All enzymes are proteins, but not all proteins are enzymes, right? So what? All enzymes are proteins. That means to say they are nitrogenous compounds, right? Obtained from plants and animals. So as they are proteins, they are made up of amino acids again, which are having some functional groups. Those are responsible for their catalytic activity. Okay, let us have some of the example for these enzymes. You can have the first one. Say for example, if you are having sucrose, C12H22O11, so then if you are made to react with an enzyme called as invertase, that is present or obtained from the yeast, invertase, what it will do? It will convert the sucrose into glucose and fructose, right? Both are having the same formula. What is this? This is nothing but the sucrose. Yes, it is glucose. It is fructose. There is a change in the functional group, but both of them are having the same molecular formula that you learn in case of your biomolecules. Yes, sucrose upon hydrolysis will be converted into glucose and fructose. Yes, likewise, you can have one more example, the fructose. C6 or glucose, C6H12O6. It may be glucose or fructose by the action of one more enzyme, that is also from the yeast, will be converted into ethanol, that is C2H5OH, with the liberation of a carbon dioxide. The liberation of carbon dioxide, that is the concept. Okay, so here it is nothing but the ethanol. This is carbon dioxide, you know that one. Which is the enzyme involved this? So these two processes where we are going to see in the manufacture of alcohol. In the manufacture of alcohol, so we are going to add the yeast that has two enzymes. One is invertase, one is zymase. Invertase convert sucrose into glucose and fructose. In turn, the zymase converts those into alcohol with the liberation of carbon dioxide. That's why you are going to see watch effervescence because of the liberation of this carbon dioxide. That is nothing but your fermentation process, right? So again, you can have one more example for this enzyme. That is, say, one enzyme is there, that is starch. So it is acted upon by the enzyme diastase, that will convert this starch into maltose, right? One more example we can have, the maltose. Maltose is a disaccharide, so it's C12H22O11. So it is acted upon by means of an enzyme that is called as maltase. For enzymes, we are going to use ASE, zymase, invertase, diastase, maltase, right? What it will do, it will convert this maltose into glucose, that is C6H12O6, maltose to glucose, that will be easily absorbed in the digestive system, right? So again, we are having one more example, that is urease. What is the form? What it will do? It will convert the urea, NH2CONH2, what is the enzyme? Urease, into ammonia and carbon dioxide. Yes, so that is the, which is the enzyme? Urease. And then you can have an example of one more enzyme that is present in our digestive system, that is nothing but pepsin. What is the enzyme? Pepsin. What it will convert? So it will convert the proteins. Where it is present? In the gastric juice, I think. That is, pepsin enzyme is present in the gastric juice, in the stomach. It will convert proteins into peptides. So then again, these peptides, so it will happen in case of stomach, this much of reaction. They will move to the small intestine. There is one more enzyme that is called as trypsin. It will convert the peptides into amino acids, right? Finally, we are having one more enzyme that will convert milk into curd, right? Which is that enzyme? Lactobacilli. There is no ACE for this one. Lactobacilli, that is the enzyme. So that is a bacteria actually, that is an enzyme which convert milk into curd, curdling of milk. So these are all the some of the examples, so which acting as a biocatalyst in case of increasing or decreasing the rate of biochemical reaction, that may be in case of plants, that may be in case of animals, right? So that is the enzymes. Then you should know about the characteristics of these enzymes. They are very, very important here. Enzymes characteristics, right? So there I am going to write the first characteristics of this enzyme. So what I am writing now or discussing now, characteristics of these enzymes. The first one is specificity. What is the meaning of this? Enzymes are highly specific in their action. See, I have written so many enzymes now. So the urease, it act only upon urea, not on starch, right? The invertase enzyme is, both of them are present in case of yeast, but the substrate, so we see here, we are going to call the reactant in case of enzyme catalyzed reaction as substrate. That also you should know. So what we call the reactant in enzyme reactions, so reactants, we call that one as the substrate, right? So the enzyme is highly specific towards its substrate. Highly specific towards its substrate. So you should know that. So enzyme, say simply if I take an enzyme, means some shape is like this, means enzyme it is. So you know that enzymes are proteins. proteins are nothing but they are made up of amino acids. So there will be amino acids here. They are having some functional group. That may be OH, that may be SH, that may be NH2, like that. That may be COOH. These are the functional groups through which it will form the bond with the substrate. Say if it is a substrate means, so that is also having some groups. Those together will combine and it will convert the substrate into the product that I am going to explain later on in case of the mechanism of enzyme action. Right? Before that, you should know that what you call for the reactant in case of enzyme catalyzed reaction as substrate. You should not use as reactant. You should use as substrate. And not at catalyst, it is an enzyme. Right? So here the enzyme is highly specific towards its substrate. That is very important. Any change, any minor change in the reactant also, it will not identify. So in the body, say for example, see what is the substrate for that trypsin enzyme? That is peptides. You are providing proteins means it will not identify that one. Because there is a change in the shape of protein, there is a change in the shape of peptides. Trypsin, it is coming from this side into intestine and some proteins are coming means it will go by this side because it will not identify. Okay, so it is highly specific. It will bind only with the watch, only with the peptides, not with the proteins. Likewise, the invertase and zymase also. So it will identify. It is specific towards its substrate. In a minor change in the structure also, it will not identify. It will not involve in that reaction. It will not bind to that one and it will not form the products. That is the very important characteristic. Again, after specificity, it is efficiency, is highly efficient, enzymes are highly efficient. What is the meaning of that? So in a fraction of second, many reactions it will catalyze. In a fraction of second, it will catalyze many reactions. That's why it is highly efficient in nature. It will produce more number of products. Are you getting the concept? So enzymes are highly specific, enzymes are highly efficient, and then they are, will be active. They will be active at a specific temperature. They will be active at a specific temperature. So the temperature range, if you have, so that is 298 Kelvin to 310 Kelvin. 310 Kelvin. That is a body, normal body temperature of an human being. 310 Kelvin is the normal body temperature of a human being. So inside the living organism, enzymes are active means because of this temperature. If there is a change in the temperature during fever and all, there will be change in the watch. The temperature, then what happens? The activity of the enzyme will be decreased. That's why, see, if you are having heavy fever means, if you given food and all means that cannot be properly digested because the activity of enzyme has been decreased, has been lower. Why? Because there is a variation in the temperature. So we call that temperature as optimum temperature. What we call for that temperature? The temperature is called as optimum temperature. It is a specific temperature at which the enzyme activity is maximum. A temperature at which the activity of enzyme is maximum. The temperature is called as what? Optimum temperature. Right? And on either side of the temperature, there will be decrease in the activity. That may be above 310 Kelvin, that may be below 298 Kelvin. There will be less activity of enzyme. There will be no activity of enzyme. So that is called as what? Optimum temperature. That is like the critical temperature. At that temperature only the enzyme will be highly active. On either side of that temperature, the activity of enzyme will be low. So what do you call for that one? Optimum temperature. What is that optimum temperature? The specific temperature at which the activity of enzyme is maximum. Activity of enzyme is maximum. What is that range? 298 Kelvin to 310 Kelvin. Likewise, so the enzymes are highly active at a specific pH. Enzymes are highly active at a specific pH. That pH is called as the optimum pH. The next point, that is optimum pH. What is this optimum pH? The pH at which activity of enzyme is maximum. Activity of enzyme is maximum. That specific pH is called as what? That specific pH is called as the optimum pH. And again, so the normal range of pH is 5 to 7, slightly acidic in nature. Right, 5 to 7. So the activity of the salivary amylase will be maximum at 6.5, like that. Salivary juice is 6.5. Then only the enzyme salivary amylase will be active. If you change the temperature, pH or temperature, no, it will no more be active. So you know the function of this salivary amylase, very important in the digestion of carbohydrates. Right? If the pH decreases, then also it will not be active. If the pH increases, then also it will not be active. So there is a graph, bell-shaped graph you are going to get. So that is nothing but this pH is 5.7 or 5 to 7 range, means here the activity will be less, here the activity will be less, but here if you take, the activity of enzyme will be maximum, highest. That the pH is called as the what? Optimum pH. And every enzyme is having its own optimum pH, that is of the range 5 to 7. Are you getting? That's why the blood pH or the our body pH will be 5 to 7. But whenever we take different types of food, no, then there will be variation in the pH. Then the activity of enzymes once again increase or decrease, usually decrease only, then there will be no proper digestion, that leads to so many problems and all. We are going to face so many problems. If you have gobi manchuri like that, means that will all acidic in nature, then they will what? Decrease the pH. If they decrease the pH, means what happens? The activity of enzymes will be lower. Right? So that's why they are highly specific towards their pH as well as the temperature, they are towards their substrate, all are highly specific. No change, minor change also they will not, they will take any minor change also they will not take that. Their activity will be lower. That's why enzymes are highly specific, enzymes are highly efficient, and they will active at a temperature called as optimum temperature, and their activity will be highest at a particular pH. That pH is called as the optimum pH. The range of that is 5 to 7 and the range of the temperature is 298 Kelvin to 310 Kelvin. Again, along with this, there are some things. So that is the activity of these enzymes will be increased by means of some substances called as the cofactors, and we are having some cofactors as well as we can have the activators and cofactors, coenzymes, or you can say cofactors. This is coenzymes and activators. See, like in case of catalyst, no, there are substances called as promoters. Likewise, there are enzymes, there are substances called as the coenzymes, right? Say they are usually vitamins. They are the non-protein part. Enzyme is the protein part. Coenzymes are the non-protein part. That may be the vitamins. They may be vitamins which increases to the what? Increases the activity of the enzyme by binding to the other site of the enzyme. Say if it is an enzyme, it is the active site of the enzyme, means where the substrate will bind, active site. Other than this active site, there will be some other places on the surface of the benzene, that is nothing but your what? Enzyme. We call that one as allosteric. What we call that one as? Allosteric site, where the substances like the coenzymes, or you can say the activators, will bind, and they increase the activity of the enzyme. Just like in case of catalyst, the promoters, the coenzymes and activators are nothing but the non-protein part. Here coenzymes are the non-protein part, usually they are vitamins. And again, activators means they may be some metal ions. Metal ions. So I can give the example for this metal ions as you can have the example of sodium ion. Where I should write? Yes, sodium ion. And manganese ion, so cobalt, and then also the copper, Cu2+, all these act as what? The activators, or they are substances called as the non-protein pot, prosthetic group also they are called as non-protein pot, or you can call, I think you are going to learn in detail in your biology. So enzymes are nothing but proteins. Proteins means amino acids, right? So if we, this is nothing but the enzyme means, so this is the active site where the reactant binds, right? Other than this active site, there will be one more place that is called as what? Allosteric site. As I said earlier, allosteric site. So what binds there? They may be coenzymes. They may be coenzymes or the activators. What are coenzymes? They are nothing but the non-protein parts. Non-protein parts. We can call them as prosthetic group also. Prosthetic group. Usually what they are? They are nothing but vitamins. Prosthetic groups are usually vitamins. Along with that, activators means some of the metal ions. As I already written there, so cobalt or your Na plus. I can give the example of this one. That is nothing but one enzyme that is called as amylase, which is present in the intestinal amylase. Right? So for the amylase enzyme, Na plus act as what? The activator. Na plus act as activator. In the presence of Na plus, its activity will be more. So this is the protein part. Whole is the protein part. This is nothing but the thing which is binding to the enzyme in the allosteric site. Allosteric site is protein part only. A total enzyme is protein. The thing which is binded to the enzyme is nothing but the non-protein part. That is nothing but the prosthetic group, or we can call that one as the vitamin. And activators are usually the metal ions. So in the presence of some metal ions and coenzymes, the activity of enzymes will be enhanced. That is a one more concept. So with that, let us move on to the, yes, understood this concept. One more thing I have to say here, that is about inhibitors. Inhibitors. So these are just like the, what is that, catalytic poisons. Inhibitors, or you can say them as poisons. Okay, so they will bind to the active site. They will bind to the active site by mimicking the substrate. Then by mimicking the substrate, they may bind to the active site, or they will bind to the allosteric site and change the shape of the enzyme. Change the shape of the active site of the enzyme. So thereby the particular substrate will not identify and the reaction will not take place. Right? Say if it is salivary amylase, means salivary amylase, its shape is like this, and then So starch is like this. That's why it is properly binding to this shape. Okay, so now if in the place of this substrate, that is the starch, if some other inhibitor binds, what they will do? They will change the shape of this catalyst, that is nothing but the biocatalyst enzyme, that is salivary amylase. Now when the actual substrate comes, can it bind to this one? No, because its shape is different and its shape is different. So like that, they are acting as poisons. They are changing the shape, active site, shape of the active site, so that the substrate will not identify them properly. So that's why they are decreasing the activity of the enzyme, or they destroying the enzymes. That's why they are called as what? Inhibitors. The substances which decrease or destroy the activity of enzyme by binding either to the active site or to the allosteric site of the bin, that is nothing but your enzymes. And then if you move on to the mechanism of enzyme action, one more important 2 marks question. It is very simple but it has been asked so many times. So what is that mechanism of enzyme action? Mechanism of enzyme action. mechanism of enzyme action. Okay, so here so many mechanisms were proposed. Out of those, lock and key mechanism is the very important. Lock and key mechanism of enzyme action is very important. So there are two steps in this, just like lock and why it is called as lock and key means, so you know that a specific lock will be open or a specific key will be open with the help of a specific lock. So if it is not specific means any key you can bring and you can open the lock, like that it is actually, right? So but it is not like that. So here the enzymes, lock and key mechanism means the specific enzyme bind to the specific substrate only, just like they are just like a lock and key, right? So what are the steps involved in that? The first one, binding of substrate, binding of, these are the steps, many times steps has also been asked, binding of substrate to the enzyme to form enzyme substrate complex, right? Are you getting the concept? Enzyme substrate complex. So that I can represent like this. So if it is E is enzyme, then the substrate will bind, leads to the formation of enzyme substrate complex. This is nothing but your enzyme substrate complex, right? So now again in the second step, step 2, what is there in the step 2? So that is decomposition, or you can say that is formation of product by the decomposition of ES complex, that is enzyme substrate complex. So how you can write that one? So that is ES, that is the enzyme substrate complex, gives rise to E plus P. What is that E here? It is enzyme, and what is P? P is nothing but the product. Look at this one. So enzyme will be regenerated at the end of a reaction without any change in it. That's why the same enzyme will continue another cycle of the reaction. Likewise, enzymes will be circulated in our body. Are you getting the concept? That is so simple it is. What are the two steps? Just you mention the steps also, that is also enough. E plus S, reversible reaction, gives rise to ES. What do you call for that one? Enzyme substrate complex. So which upon decomposition leads to form the enzyme and product. Once the reactants react together, so that is reactants means substrate react together. So it will form into the product will be dissolved from the surface of the enzyme. This is actually happened. So see, if it is enzyme, that is nothing but your, what is, we have written so many enzymes. It's one of the enzyme, if I take this one as invertase, what is the substrate here? Sucrose. Then sucrose will bind to the enzyme, that is nothing but the invertase, that will form a complex. Upon decomposition, it will form into what? This enzyme invertase with the formation of two products. One is glucose, one is fructose. Likewise, two steps are there in the mechanism: enzyme substrate complex formation and then decomposition of that complex to form the enzyme and the product. They have given a beautiful picture in the textbook. There, they have represented this enzyme as a key, say somewhat like this, say for example, this is a enzyme means, then substrate they have indicated, it should be fixed, no? That's why there should be groove here. It is a structure of same place I had to represent, thereby it should fix here properly, right? It is a substrate, So how to represent this enzyme substrate complex? So it will be like this, same shape. Okay, now the enzyme will be fixed like this. What you call for this one? This is called as enzyme substrate complex. Again, you have to remove this one. So there will be enzyme with the same shape. Okay, then there will be a product of different shape or whatever it may be. This is called as product. This is called as lock and key mechanism. Specific key will open the specific lock. Likewise, specific enzyme will convert specific substrate into a product. That's why it is called as lock and key mechanism. So, and then lastly, if you end up the concept of this enzymes, so that is industrial importance of catalyst. Industrial importance of catalyst or commercial importance of catalyst. I already discussed that one, but now again I have to summarize those, or you can say, you can list out those industrial importance. You know about that is the last concepts in case of this catalysis. Industrial importance of catalyst. Catalyst. Okay. Yes, the first one is in the manufacture of ammonia by Haber's process. A catalyst is used in the manufacture of ammonia by, yes, what is the name of a process? Haber's process. Right, you simply represent that reaction. So N2G plus 3H2G. So catalyst is iron. So it will form into 2NH3. This is the use of iron catalyst in the manufacture of ammonia by Haber's process. That is the industrial use also, we can say. Industrial importance, commercial importance of this catalyst. Then the second one, in the manufacture of sulfuric acid by, what is the name of that process? Yes, I am telling again, repeating, very important questions these are in the P block elements. Out of these three, what I am going to write now, anyone will be asked in the final exams, right? By contact process. Yes, what is the reaction? Sulfur dioxide converted into sulfur trioxide. With balance, it is 2SO3. What is the name of that catalyst? That is vanadium pentoxide or chromium oxide also you can use here. Vanadium pentoxide or chromium oxide also you can use the as the catalyst for the oxidation of sulfur dioxide to sulfur trioxide. Very, very important step in case of what? Contact process, particular temperature and pressure also you have to mention. At that temperature and pressure only the catalyst go through that one. So here also the temperature and pressure are very, very important. At that temperature and pressure only the catalyst will be active and convert the reactants into products. And one more is there, that is nothing but manufacture of nitric acid. Nitric acid by Ostwald process. What is that reaction? The first step itself is the dependent on the catalyst, that is 4-5. I told at that time, ammonia plus 5 oxygen in the presence of platinum ruridium at a particular temperature and pressure, they are very important again. So it leads to the formation of nitric oxide and water molecule, right? So these are the some of the industrially important reactions where there is a use of catalyst. That's why catalysts are very, very important, as well as enzymes are very, very important. So together, catalysis concept is very important. So you are going to get many questions in this. So just go through that one. So thereby you are going to get. Okay. So I will end up today's concept up to this. In the last class, we are going to discuss about the last concept of this chapter, that is about the collides. Thank you.